Hello everyone, welcome back to the password-based security system series. In this video, I will be outlining the main components that our project will be using, and of course, the selection of our main component will be directly connected from the system requirements that we drafted in the previous video. I have put a link in the description box below, so if you haven't seen it, go check it out. Before I proceed, please show me your support by clicking the subscribe button below. This will also get you updates on new videos related to this series. Full disclosure, the components I am using are the ones that I have in my toolbox. There may be other components that are much more efficient, but this is what I have, so I guess I'll stick with them. But if you have a much better one in mind, I'd love to hear them in the comment section below. Let's begin. For the input, I will be using a 4x4 matrix array keypad. However, if you have a lot of time in your hands and likes to make this from scratch, you can make one using switch buttons. For output message, I will be using a 16x2 character LCD module. And just for added effect, I'm also going to throw in an RGB LED to show specific color indicating the status of the system. For example, I'll light up a green when the system is locked, a red when it is unlocked, and a blinking red if the alarm is triggered. For the output alarm or confirmation sound, I'll be using a buzzer. And for conveying that the system is locked or unlocked, I'm going to put in a servo to turn it to a specific position when system is locked and to another position when the system is unlocked. And now for the selection of the brain of the project. There are now a lot of options to do this, from a microcontroller to an Arduino to a Raspberry Pi. The selection is big, but for educational purposes, I'd want to go with a microcontroller because this takes away all the abstraction layers that is already on top of the Arduino and the Raspberry Pi. When selecting a microcontroller, there are several factors that should be considered for a hobbyist or student, and these are the ROM-RAM capacity, the peripherals available, and if you want to run it on batteries, you should also consider the power consumption per gigahertz. For the ROM-RAM capacity, what the developer usually do when they select one is that they already have a metrics in hand that they can base on. In my job, for example, when we select a new microcontroller from a new manufacturer, we base our required ROM-RAM capacity on the current ROM-RAM footprint of our firmware. But if the selection of the chip will be for a new project that we don't have anything to base on, then we get the chip with a higher than normal ROM-RAM capacity in that family. And after the project is successfully launched, we do a value engineering to change the microcontroller in case the one we selected is way too big. In that way, the company saves thousands of dollars. For a hobbyist, you should also do the same way, especially if you don't have any experience yet on the project you are creating, so that you have enough room to play around. Next will be the consideration of the microcontroller's peripherals and available features. This should support the devices that we plan to hook onto the microcontroller. For the keypad, we need 7 GPIO pins. For the 2x16 LCD, we need 7 GPIO pins. RGB LEDs, we need 3 GPIO pins or 3 PWM peripherals. Buzzer, 1 GPIO pin, and servo, 1 PWM peripheral. I only have two different types of microcontrollers in my toolbox, and they are PIC16F877A and PIC24FJ64GB002. Here is a table differentiating the features and peripherals of the two. For the PIC16F877A, it has 14.3K program memory, 368 data SRAM, 256 double EEPROM, 33 I/O, 8 10-bit analog-to-digital converter, 2 CCP modules, 2 8-bit timer or 1 16-bit timer, and 2 comparators. For the PIC24FJ64GB002, we have 28 pins, 64KB program memory, 8K SRAM, 15 remappable pins, 5 16-bit timer, 5 capture input, 5 compare or PWM output, 2 UART with IRDA, 2 SPI, 2 I2C, 29 1-bit analog to digital channel, and 3 comparators. Given the numbers, it's quite obvious that we should go for the PIC24FJ64. It has more than enough ROM and RAM for our program, and we can use up to 5 PWM out, which will make the implementation of the RGB LAN together with the server easy. But if you already have experience creating this type of project, the PIC16F877A will suffice, although you will have to make a complex code to make the RGB LAN run given the limited number of PWM modules available, or you can replace it with a red and green LEDs. And that's it for this lesson. I hope you were able to take something from this. Please give me a thumbs up if you do. If you have questions, drop me a message in the comment section. I'll see you on my next video.